morning, church. I just want to welcome everybody that's here this morning and anybody who's joining us online right now. It's great to be together in God's presence, to spend some time in worship and reading from Scripture. I want to invite everybody to stand and join us on this beautiful Sunday morning here. It's great weather for a holiday weekend, right? Plus the Buckeyes won yesterday. I mean, it was a little messy, but they won. Dub's a dub, right? Okay. Awesome. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer and just dedicate this time to Him. Lord, we are just here in this house right now to honor You, God, to give You presence, and just to be in Your glory. We love You, Lord, and as we just get ready to worship You right now, we pray that Your presence be made known to each and every one of us here in this place. God, You know what we need, and You know where we need to be met. And God, we just come expecting of an encounter with You. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
As we get ready to sing one more song together, we're going to take up our tithes and offerings right now. There's instructions on how to do it on the screen if you want to give digitally. There's also blue boxes by the doors you walked in the back of the room there. And as we get ready to just enter into worship with tithes and offerings as well, we just want to take a moment to pray for God's anointing and blessing on those, Lord. God, we just pray right now that, well, first, God, we just thank you for every provision that you've given us, Lord. You are our provider. You are our King. As we get ready to give back to you freely from what you've given to us, Lord, we just pray for your anointing, your blessing, Lord. God, that you would anoint these houses. God, that you would reach the people in this world around us that don't know you yet.
Come on, my soul.
give him praise in this place today, Lord. We thank you so much. Heart of gratitude. Jesus, as we get ready to study your word today, we just pray that you would speak to every heart and mind in this place, God, that we'd have just discernment to hear your word and know it and apply it to our lives. Come before you now in this presence, ready and eager to be closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, well, good morning. Welcome Pastor Ezekiel Rurumbira to the stage. Please, all right, yeah, it's on, amen. It's on. Yeah, you're good, you're good. So Ezekiel is a pastor here at the church, and he pastors the, I don't want to say our Congolese congregation, because we're all one congregation, but our Congolese members of our church. And we're going to get into things in just a minute, but actually my first question, how do I look? How do I look?
It's amazing.
It's amazing? I thought you said messy at first. It's amazing. Good. I'll tell you what, I walked in, and I attracted a lot of attention. And some of you were looking at me like, that's not your vibe. Well, you're absolutely wrong. This is my vibe. And so thank you for the shirt. I appreciate
it. Thank you so
much. It's an honor. It really is to wear it. So I appreciate that. So we have taken up a collection for your home village of Minembwe at multiple times, okay? And if you don't know, if you haven't been with us for a while, it's a war-torn area, really. I mean, there are marauding tribes, the Maimai, that have really wreaked havoc on the people where you live. And in fact, that's why you and your family are here.
Yes.
You've been resettled here
yes.
for your safety. Okay, so it's really become near and dear to our hearts. We care deeply about the people of Minembwe. You recently took a trip. Tell us about it.
Thank you, Pastor Ryan.
Yeah.
First of all, let me say thank you. You remember when we started this year, January 15, mm-hmm. we have prayer, special prayer, to pray for my country, to pray for my community, Banyamulenge. Yeah. From the day we pray, God is answer. We now have 100% peace. Let me say we have every 100 peace in Minembwe now.
Mm-hmm.
That is good.
Yep.
That is good.
It's gotten much better.
From the day we pray, no more Maimai to come to kill people, no more Interahamwe to come to kill people from the day until now. Number two.
The UN's gotten much more involved
yes,
than they were,
yes,
correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's okay. UN involved, but our prayer is special
that's
for
right.
UN.
Yep, that's right.
Yeah.
I agree. Yep.
Number two, when we go on a trip in Congo, we go in Uvira. Uvira is close for Burundi border. We have 4 days, Thursday to Sunday, with Helen and Phil.
Yep. Our very own Phil and Ellen.
That is good.
And Ellen spoke.
Let me say
yes.
thank you for your prayer. Let me say thank you for your support, for everything you do for us, me and Helen Philip. God can bless for you. We have a nice day. We have a special Mama Victory. Helen, she's nice mama. She's a nice preacher. I can't believe she can preach 4 days, 2 hours. 2 hours. It's amazing. When I see her, when she takes 2 hours, she preaching. My eyes fill to cry to say, thank you, God, to bring Helen in Congo.
Yes.
A lot of people in Banyamulenge, in Bafulero, Babembe, in Uvira say, Ezekiel, she's America or not? Because she know here, we preach 45 minutes. Thank you for your prayer and your support.
Oh, absolutely. Thank you. Ezekiel and his family have poured so much into this congregation, and really, we just wouldn't be the same without you. So tell us. We've actually given to a number of things in Minembwe.
Yes.
So if you've given to that, and a lot of you have, a lot of that money's gone to very good places. But this was really the most at one particular time, okay,
yes.
that you took with you. How was that money spent?
When parishes send money, 2,800, to in my account. It's donation for church. Mm-hmm. After conference in Uvira, I tried to fund the airplane to go to Minembwe. But the UN refused me to go to Minembwe because I'm not have again nationality for Congolese. I am American now.
Yeah, you're American. Yeah.
He say, you can't do that. You can't go there because right. You lose your nationality in the Congolese. You from America now. Mm-hmm. After that, I moved Burundi to go in Goma to see I can found private airplane. Yeah. To go there in Minembwe. Mm-hmm. The airplane in Goma is no regular to say, like here, when you buy a ticket, to say, after 3 hours, I can take flight to go there. Mm-hmm. I'm not found the airplane, but I send someone, his name Eric Kalimba Sered, I give money to go in Minembwe to buy the material you see. Mm-hmm. This material, we give 90 people. For 900, we buy 2 cows. He's not see cow?
Oh no, do we have, yeah, there we go.
Yes.
There we go, yep. That.
Another cow.
Another cow?
Yes, it's 2.
Do we have any more cows?
Black cow, yes.
Okay, we just have a picture of the one cow, sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, it probably looks a lot like this one.
Okay. I told him, go in Minembwe, after that call the leader for church to ask them, this money, how can you use? You need to know exactly which you need to use this money. The leader for church say we need the material for women. Secondly, we need to buy 2 cows to have milk to give people.
All right.
We grew up in Minembwe for cow. If Banyamulenge is not have milk, the life is no good.
How did we stay in the lights through all that? We just had a power glitch.
Yeah.
And we somehow stayed in the light. So
this
is what happens when you're with Ezekiel, everybody.
Yeah, we buy 2 cows for 900 or for 1,000. 1 cow is 600, another one is 400.
Okay.
We buy ticket for guys for Eric for round trip. Mm-hmm. From Gomini Minembwe is 240. To back Minembwe to Goma is 140. And we pay tax for airport.
Okay.
Goma and Minembwe is $30.
Okay.
Yes. After that, I give him money to stay in a hotel in Minembwe for 7 days. And I give him ticket to back home in Uvira. And we pay the hotel for 2 weeks. We live in Kisenyi before he go in Minembwe.
Yeah, okay. So there are travel expenses, but really,
yes,
this money went towards things that people just absolutely need to live,
yes.
Things that we take for granted.
Yeah.
So I'll tell you what, and I want to tell you, on behalf of everybody here, we continue to support you.
Thank you.
And we want to express our gratitude
thank
for the
so
life
much.
That you have brought to this congregation.
Thank you.
Yes,
thank you
so much.
Thank you.
Okay, let's give him a hand and let's pray. Things have gotten so much better. It's still not perfectly safe, and there are still people sitting in refugee camps and people that are without homes. So we need to continue to pray.
Thank you. Let's do that together. Thank
all right,
you.
My friend. All right, so Lord, we're grateful. We are for the Ruhrenbeer family and just what they bring to this church, Lord. And I had somebody pray over us once when we first came to the church and said, Flum family, they're like sparklers. Well, this family is like, they're like sparklers. They really are. They light up things around them. And so thank you for that. Thank you for what they show us. Please be with this village of Minembwe.
Thank you.
Father, continue to keep them safe. We're glad. We express our gratitude for what you've done. But continue, Lord, to sustain them and give them everything they need. In Jesus' name,
amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, my friend. Yes.
Thank you.
So I mean this one here. We need to, the booth, the people that work in the booth, they are absolutely the unsung heroes. You only notice them if something goes wrong. That was a super quick turnaround for a power recycle. So let's give the booth a hand. All they do, and actually everybody that serves in the booth, thank you. It means so much. So all right, we are up and going. So the most pervasive, influential, destructive idea in our society today is one that falls under the radar. In fact, we're kind of like, you've heard the metaphor, we're kind of like fish in water, and it's just all around us, and we don't even see that we're floating there in the water, and it's an assumption of modern life. So much we do, so much we think, so much we speak and say out loud and experience. We just don't realize just how all over the place, how ubiquitous this idea is. And so over the next 3 weeks, we want to kind of bring this idea, dig deep up out of the muck and expose it to the light and really take a look, become aware of what it is and just how bad it is on our lives and how much we as Christians have even discovered just how seductive it is. And we've kind of bought into it. We've gotten pulled into this, just this really influential idea. Well, that's so funny. I was just about to say, are you curious? Well, evidently you are. So it's that humans can create an image of ourselves. We can create this, you know, how we look on the outside and the things that we say and the way that we smile and our posture and the way that we carry ourselves. We can create an image of ourselves that's different than what's actually going on with us, that's different who we actually are. Not only, society says, not only can you do that, you can create you. You can create your own identity. It actually says, and you should. This is a good endeavor. This is a worthwhile endeavor. This is what it is to be human, is to create this public version of ourselves. So there's a book that came out recently by a woman named Tara Isabella. And she talks about this very notion, this idea in the modern world that we can and should create our identity, create an image of ourselves. It's called self-made. It's worth checking out. Here's what she says. She says, by self-made, I mean not just that they, people, shape their own destinies or change their social circumstances, but that the cultivation of one's own personality, inventing who you are for all the world to see. That's what she's saying. The cultivation of one's own personality in accordance with one's desires is basically what it means to be human. Or, here's a quote from Stuart Brand, somebody that completely buys into this idea. This is not satire. This guy actually means this. If we could have that next quote up here. He says, we are as gods, so we might as well get good at it. Might as well be good at being gods. What's he mean by gods? Like Greek gods and goddesses? No, that's not the idea. Gods meaning you have the power to paint meaning onto the world and to paint meaning into your own life. It's a really seductive idea, and it's all over the place. What we think, we create this image that says to the world, we have our basic desires that make us humans. We have those fulfilled. We have the wealth. We have the approval. We have the friends. We have the career. We have the home. We have the cuisine. We have the expression of our sexuality that makes us human. And so I want to sum it up. Here's the most pervasive, influential, and destructive idea out there today is that you can and should mold your personality into any image that you desire. Now, it should be really easy to see that this is pervasive and it's really influential. Does everybody agree with that? This is modern living. Like, don't keep it simple on this one. This isn't complicated. We see this all over the place. This is absolutely us. Look at social media. Here's my dinner. Here's what I ate for dinner. Like, we post this stuff. What are we really trying to say? I have great culinary taste. Look at me. Here's my shoes. Here's a picture of these shoes that I just bought. Don't I have great taste in fashion? Here's the beach. Here's the beach where I go, my family and I go. Don't I have great recreational taste? Here's the office where I work. Don't I have great workplace prestige? Here's my kids. Here's my family. Don't we have a happy put-together home? You ever just amazed that everybody's got a perfectly put-together home but you? Like, you're it. You ever feel like this? Yeah, of course. Like, everybody's got the perfect family, the perfect home, the perfect life with their friends. They're always out partying, and they're smiling. They're having a good time. You can hear the soundtrack behind it. All this and more is pretty familiar to us. It's pretty familiar that these things are influential and they're pervasive. We create an image of ourselves. Why they are destructive, though, that's where we want to really home in and talk about. They're pervasive. This idea is pervasive. It's influential. Why is it so destructive? That's a little less obvious. So in this series called Identity Crisis, because if there's a way, it's very hard to sum up a culture that's become as complex as ours in just a little phrase, but if I had to do that, that would be my phrase, identity crisis. We're not clear who we are as a people. Sometimes we're not even clear who we are as the church, the big C church. We're not clear on who we are as people, and sometimes we just feel like the best we have is to try to create this image of ourselves. Here's the problem. It leads to a big pack of things that they make you miserable. They really do. They make you miserable. Has anybody just stayed away from social media for a period of time, a week or two? And I will just guess. I will thank you for that hand. One person has done it. I will just guess that you felt a relief of some of that stress and anxiety and pressure and comparing yourself to other people. I can't imagine you didn't. The data's in on this stuff, everybody. The data is in on our online presence, our online image making, social media, all these things. And we know it increases anxiety and depression. Like nobody, you cannot, like empirically, you just can't argue that anymore. The studies are in, the data's in. Our phones, you know, carrying our phones around. These things make us more anxious. But we're so hooked. Do you see this? We're so hooked that we do it anyway. We do this thing that we know. We know it's destructive. They've done plenty of studies on this. We don't even need to pay for another study. We know it hurts us, and yet we just keep going. And so there's three big lies with respect to our identity. We talk about identity. We're talking about questions like, who am I? Why am I here? Am I enough? Who am I? Why am I here? Am I enough? And so we're going to dig into what these lies are. But first, I want to tell you, you want to hear some good news? I would like to say some good news after saying all that stuff. That doesn't exactly make you feel great. Here's the good news. There are actually, and I'm not sure, I thought about this quite a bit this week. If you can think of a third, come tell me after the service. But there's actually not just one way of finding your identity, who you are in this world. But I actually think there really might just be two. There might just be two options. The first of these we just talked about. You self-create. Your life is a blank slate, and you just have to impute or give it meaning by self-making, by creating an image, by creating an identity. That's the first one. But the good news is there is actually another option, but it is so radically different than the first option. I can't even begin to tell you it's so different. The second option is not that you're self-creating, not that you're making these things up, but that your identity, who you are, is given to you. It's spoken over you. It's something that cannot be added to or subtracted, no matter how good you are or how bad you are, the things that you do. It comes about simply because you were created a certain way, to get more specific, because God Himself made you with identity, with purpose, with value. There's nothing to create, there's nothing to add, there's nothing to subtract. Two big ways of thinking about yourself and why you matter. Okay? The first of these, I am created by God for a purpose. versus I create myself for my own purpose. This sums up our society, and you can think of just about any hot button issue that we argue about, any moral issue, all these things going on today. Really, to sum it all up, it's a battle. It's a battle of the mind and the heart and the will between these two ways of thinking about humans and why we matter. I am created by God for a purpose versus I create myself for my own purpose. It's a fundamental division in the universe. These are strong statements. I mean them. It's a fundamental division in the universe. And so here's what we're going to do over the next 3 weeks. We're going to look at three big lies that come about because of the self-creation idea, the self-creation way of thinking about our identity. And then for each one of those, here's what I would love if you had walking away from this series. For each one of those, I'm going to give you four realities. From the Bible, we're going to do a lot of verses. We're going to look at a lot of verses. A lot of times I kind of like to, you're more used to, I kind of like to have a passage that we hang in for a long time. This is going to be a little different. We're going to look at a lot of different verses from the Bible. And so there's going to be four truths or four realities that God says about you, that you were just created that way. They're true about you no matter how many good things you do or no matter how many bad things you do. They're just true for you. So if you do the math, you're going to walk away with 12 things. 12 things. Four to one. Four answers for each lie. All right? And we're going to hear the gospel. Everything Jesus says is good news. That you have an identity. That you have a purpose. That you don't just have to create your image to give yourself value and worth. That is good news. That is gospel news. And so if you just hang with me and let yourself be absorbed in this, you're going to smile, I think. You're going to feel a sense of wonder. You're going to feel a sense of peace. I'll never forget a guy that lived close to a church, actually right behind a church. My father was pastoring. This was during the purpose-driven life days. Remember the purpose-driven life days? Everybody was doing 40 days of purpose. Maybe even had a mug that said it or something like that, or a t-shirt, okay? Some of the laughs I'm hearing, you did. You had a mug or a t-shirt, didn't you? So that's good. And I remember him saying, as he read this book, he just could not stop smiling. This is a guy that did not know Jesus before this, just couldn't stop smiling. I think that's what we're going to experience. All right, so big lie number one. Big lie that comes about because of the self-creation way of thinking of my identity. And it's going to be familiar to everybody. You ready? It's not, no big surprises here. I am not enough. That is, we all tell ourselves this. We all have narratives going up here that tell ourselves in one way or another that I am not enough. I can't do enough. I can't accumulate enough. I can't spend enough. I can't look good enough. That's a natural kind of lie that comes about by thinking I have to create my own image to give myself worth, to give myself value, meaning, purpose. And so now let's shift gears. Let's hear what God has to say, but I'd like us to do an exercise first. And this is, there is no manipulation, there's no arm twisting in this room whatsoever. I'm going to invite you to close your eyes and go through an exercise. If you don't want to, just sounds weird to you, just zone out. Think about the game last night or something. You can do whatever you want. It's up to you. But I'd invite you into this exercise because I think I want us, and this is actually something Christians have done for centuries. It's a forgotten practice, what we're about to do. But I think it puts us in the right place to receive from God because it shows us just how empty our lives are without the meaning that he gives because he created us. So here's how it's going to go. I'm going to invite you to imagine a scene in your life that shows you just the bankruptcy, the dead-end way of thinking that is this I have to create myself that'll put us in a posture to be ready to hear from God. Yeah? Yeah. Okay, good. All right, so let's do this. I'd invite you to, I think this is easier. It's easier for me to visualize if you close your eyes, but you don't have to. Okay. So imagine that there you are, and you're living in a mansion. And you've got a bunch of precious metal of some kind, gold, whatever you like. And you've got it stockpiled. And you think to yourself, I have arrived. I have scaled the tower. Like I have arrived. So just let yourself go there. And now imagine, for whatever reason, because these things are fleeting, it is all of it is taken away from you. And all that you have left are some clothes that they've actually become rags. They've gotten so worn out. And you're now without a home. And you're living on the streets. You've got nothing. You literally have to beg for your basic needs. And just kind of try to feel that. Do your best to get in that mindset. I know we've got a lot of stuff. It's hard for us. But imagine now you got nothing. You've got absolutely nothing. And all that treasure that you accumulated, you now see that was meaningless. It was worthless. You don't know where your shelter is going to come from. You don't know where your next drink of water is going to come from. You don't know where your next meal is going to come from. And suddenly a man shows up, and you know that it's Jesus. And you look at him in your just your extreme poverty and brokenness, and you say, Lord, help me. Help me. And Christians from the ancient world into the Middle Ages and the modern era would tell us, now you're ready to receive from God. If you're in this posture of seeing your own brokenness and your own poverty, you're ready to receive from God because that's very real. That is real. That is actually the way things are. And so with respect to our identity, that's where we are, everybody. That's where we are. We are in that much poverty through the things that the world has to give. So let's receive from them. By the way, this is an exercise you can do at home, and I do this from time to time. It puts you in the right posture to see just how much you need God. Ephesians 2:10, so let's hear. Let's hear, what's real? If the lie is, I am not enough, and this is a natural consequence, now we're ready to receive. We're ready to receive like children. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things that he planned long ago for us to do. We are God's masterpiece. You are God's masterpiece. So when Paul says this, he's writing to the church at Ephesus. And you need to know that there was a Greek goddess named Artemis. And there was a big statue, idol, to Artemis in Ephesus. And the idea was, the thought was, the belief was, is that this goddess had dropped down directly from heaven to the people at Ephesus to be their goddess. And so the people there would say, the Ephesians would say, Artemis is the masterpiece of the gods. This thing, this image, this thing that you can identify yourself, like this is the masterpiece of the gods. And Paul says, well, actually, that's just stone. But God does have a masterpiece. It's you. It's me. It's the people who he created. You are God's artwork. Reality number one today is not I am not enough. It's I am God's masterpiece. You are God's masterpiece. He's made us beautiful, valuable. We're living, breathing artwork. Do you believe this? We're living, breathing artwork. God looks at us and he sees the height of his creation. He sees all the beauty in the world. And sorry, Booth, I know I'm bouncing around. Let's go back to these. So think about like these beautiful artworks. Think about these things that in human history that are considered masterpieces. Michelangelo's David. If we can have that picture up there. How's it going? Okay, there we go. Good. This is a master. By the way, we're going to do a headshot because David didn't dress modestly that day. But this is unbelievable. Like, I called this up. I've never been to see this. Maybe you've been to see this. Good for you. And I thought, okay, this is like a computer rendering of what it would have looked like if they had modern tools, ways of sculpting. Like, this is, this, no, and that, so I looked at like four or five pictures before I was convinced. Like, I have an inner skeptic in me. I do. But this is real. Like, this much detail. And it's this lifelike. Or what about the Mona Lisa? Again, just considered a masterpiece. In fact, if you Google, because I did this, this is so unsophisticated. Never think that I have aesthetic taste or I'm aesthetically sophisticated, because I Google best painting ever. What's the best painting ever? But it's pretty close to unanimous. It's at least consensus. The Mona Lisa survived for a very long time. Or what about Van Gogh's Starry, Starry Night? Do you like this one? Yeah. It's a great painting. If you see this, just the depth of the brush strokes and the emotion that goes into it. These are things that have absolutely stood the test of time. But they're not God's masterpiece. They're inspired by God. They're not God's masterpiece. You are God's masterpiece. That's right. Amen to that. And so Psalm 139 says this: "For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb." Think about that for a minute. We're not taking any credit away from moms. Moms, you do so much out there, you do. But at the end of the day, what was knitting you together, making you into a human being, that was the very work of God. I believe this is literally true. God was involved in your formation and continues to be. Unbelievable stuff. "I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well." Or even at the very beginning of creation. This will blow your mind if you've never heard this before. This is unreal stuff. So God created the first humans in his own image. He did not create them in the image they will one day make of themselves. The dinner that they just ate, the shoes that they just purchased, the wonderful, beautiful home that they've created, the great vacations they take. No, actually, God created you in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female. He created them. We're thinking, willing, feeling creatures like God. We're not going to be as wise as God, right? As smart as God. But he's imprinted some of that on us. We have the capacity for wisdom, love, compassion, justice, gentleness. Do not believe the hype in this world. Do not believe it. It's all just hype. You can't create yourself. That's just a treadmill you're going to be on. You are God's masterpiece. You are enough because God created you with intentionality. I want to give you 20 seconds or so just to let that first one sink in. I am God's masterpiece. Just a moment of silence. If you want to close your eyes, that's fine. But just like whatever images come to mind, but I am God's masterpiece. Let it sink in. All right. Let's go to the second reality. The second thing that's true. It's not true that you're not enough. But here's the second thing that's true. Second of 12. Remember, there's 12 of these coming over the next 3 weeks. I am accepted by God. It's okay to want to be accepted. That's a natural impulse. If you're not accepted, like, we want to belong places. If you're not accepted, if you're not embraced, if you're not brought into the inner circle, it's very hard to belong. It's a major part of why we do the image creating we do, is because we want to be accepted. We want to belong. You hearing me? We don't always know why we're doing what we're doing, but a lot of the reasons that you're like documenting everything you do on social media, or creating an image with the wardrobe that you wear, or the friends that you keep, or whatever, you just want to feel accepted. You want to feel like you belong. That's okay. That is not a bad impulse. What's destructive is that we think somehow that we can create an identity through these things, through sort of forcing this idea of acceptance or belonging. And so what's going to happen is you're never going to feel like you're enough. If you have to create this image so that you feel like you're accepted and you feel like belong by what you wear and the friends you keep and the vacations that you take and all these things. You're never going to feel like you belong. There's this thing that psychologists call imposter syndrome. You ever heard of imposter syndrome? Like, I can't imagine anybody in this room hasn't felt it at one point or another. You feel like you're in a certain group. You feel like you're the imposter. You feel like you're the one that doesn't belong. They all kind of get it. These people all kind of get it. They're all sort of part of the same club. But I'm the imposter. I'm the one that doesn't fit there. I've had that multiple times in my life, from friend groups to you know, different spaces in high school, grade school, even being in the ministry. Feeling like, oh, there's this it thing that pastors have, and I don't have that. I'm just a guy, you know. Imposter syndrome. You're always going to feel this way. Well, let me tell you what. This is no small thing. This is no cliche, no platitude. This is life and this is light. You are accepted by God. You belong because of Him. You never have to say, there is no place that I belong, because in the deepest sense of all, you absolutely do belong. Romans 15. Accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you. Just as He drew you in, just as He brought you in and made you part and made it such that you belong. You are not an imposter with Jesus Christ. In order to bring praise to God, He says, and the interesting thing is, we can genuinely accept one another. That can happen in the church if it's based on the reality that Christ accepted us. So let's give it a few seconds. Just let it sink in. Pray it back to God, whatever you want to do. I am accepted by God. All right, we got this lie that we believe because we're like hamsters on the hamster wheel. We're running on a treadmill. We're not getting anywhere with this self-creation stuff. And we just eventually throw up our hands and say, I'm not enough. Well, third reason that that's not true. I am treasured by God. You are treasured. This is a deep and important word in the Bible that comes up in a number of places. If you're treasured, you're held close. You're held affectionately. You have deep value to the person who treasures you above any stuff that this world can offer. So think about the things we treasure. We treasure children. We treasure a spouse. We treasure a good friend or a family member, an heirloom, certain places we can even treasure. We like stuff. We like our iPhones, maybe. Do you like your iPhone, or is it kind of a... I'm very ambivalent with respect to my iPhone. I have a real love-hate relationship. Does that speak to some people here? Yeah, I have a real love-hate relationship with that phone. But we like stuff. We like our car. But treasuring is special. Treasuring is holding near and dear. God actually, just imagine this. This is wonder of wonders. But if all this stuff in the Bible is true, what I'm about to say is true. God has affection when He sees you, when God looks at you, not just humanity, yes, that too, when God looks at you, He has joy, He has delight, He has pride in His heart. You're treasured by Him, you're special, just like His child. And so Deuteronomy 7 says this, for you are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you out of all the peoples on the face of the earth to be His people, His treasured possession. Now again, this is talking about the people of Israel, and I think it applies to the church. But if God treasures His church, treasures His people, He treasures every single one of us. It's not a leap to say what this is saying is that God treasures you. Is that amazing to you? Yeah. Okay, so let's let it sink in. I'm treasured by God. The last reason today. Four. You'll have a third of them. Try to give you this one. The last reason that it just can't be the case that I'm not enough, that you're not enough. That cannot be the case. Why? Well, I am well planted by God. Well planted. What the world does that mean? Like, one of these things is not like the other. I mean, that seems that way, right? These other three, you can kind of wrap your head around it, that maybe you expected that. I am well planted by God. This is part of your identity. This is part of who you are. That person, and what this verse is saying, just to give you a little context, we need context to these things. The person who meditates on God's word, who carries it with him or her. This is talking about time in your Bible, but this is just talking about you're drawing and living your life from the life-giving words that God gives us all the time. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. So let us sink in. Let that image of a tree that's just flourishing, its leaves are flourishing, it's bearing fruit. What, this tree is doing so incredibly well. Why? Well, it has what it needs. It's planted by streams of living water. It's one of my favorite scenes, actually, when I'm out hiking. And you can get this, you can be in the mountains somewhere. You can be 20 minutes from home right here in Columbus. And you can get this. These trees, and sometimes even the roots are exposed, yeah? Planted by streams of living water. It's not going to run dry. So you might feel like, I don't have enough. I don't have what it takes. I don't measure up. Well, by the standards that you're using, really nobody does. So that's the bad news. That's the bad news. Yeah, you're right. But you're not as special as you think. Because what we really think when we say, I don't measure up, I don't have enough, it's not just that. It's that other people do. Nothing steals your joy, hear me, like comparing yourself to others. There's almost nothing in life that'll steal your joy like comparing yourself to other people. When you say, I am not enough, that's a comparative statement. You're not just saying me in isolation in a vacuum. It's I don't have enough and other people do. Well, that's true of all of us. But if you're a tree planted by streams of water, you have everything you need. Do you hear me? Why? What is a stream? What does water signify in the scripture? It's life. Yeah, it absolutely signifies life. And it signifies the Holy Spirit giving that life. If you're planted by streams of living water, it means you have everything you need because you have God's Spirit. Do you hear me? You, like you have everything you need because you have the Spirit of God. This is truth. This is reality. These are things you can stand upon. It's not like you go down the road to OSU and that's an institution of learning and this is where I learn about human life. Like this is very real. This is knowledge on par with all of that. This is something you can take to the bank. About yourself. If you walk with Jesus Christ, you're planted by streams of living water and you have everything you need. So let's bring this home. This idea that I am not enough, I don't measure up, that gets pretty dicey if the route you're going to go is I must create myself and give myself meaning. You might actually end up at I am not enough. In fact, you probably will. But the good news is, this idea that I am not enough is implausible. It's not just implausible or improbable. It is absolutely out of the question. You hear me? This idea that I am not enough, I do not measure up, that is implausible. That is out of the question. It is patently false. If we know that we are created intentionally by a good God made in his image. I am his masterpiece. I am accepted. I am treasured. I am planted. Take another moment to let it sink in, and then I'm going to wrap up with a verse. I am all those things. Here's the clincher, 2 Corinthians 3. Think of everything we just said, those four big realities from Scripture. Such is the confidence. Does that not fit? Is that not fitting after all this? You say, such is the confidence that we have through Christ towards God. Not that we are sufficient in ourselves to claim anything is coming from us, our image, our identity, our worth, meaning, but our sufficiency is from God. All right, let's pray. Lord, give us time to smile. Give us time to bask in that. May it just soak into the fibers of our being, who we are, hearts, minds, souls, will. Now the pressure's off. You heard everybody? The pressure is off. Because we matter. We're valuable. We're enough. Because Jesus Christ is sufficient for all we need. Amen. All right, so we're going to go into a time of communion now. I'd invite guest services to come forward and begin to pass out the elements. So we will sing together, we'll worship together. Really, worshiping now, this is a way of responding to the goodness of what God has given us through His Word. That's what we're going to do together. And then we're going to continue to respond back to Him. Worship, adoration back to Him. We partake together afterward. the night he was betrayed. Jesus wanted the disciples who were there with him to have a way of remembering and commemorating, having it just sink down into their souls, what it is he was about to do in his death and subsequent resurrection. And so in his wisdom, he took the bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body that's broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Same way he took a cup. So this is my blood that's shed for you. It's poured out for the forgiveness of sins that you may walk into new life. It's God's promise. It's a covenant that he will be with us directly. So he says, do this in remembrance of me. It's Lord, we receive these things like children. Give us childlike faith, childlike trust, childlike hope, knowing that you are God over all the universe. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. In just a moment, I'll do the blessing. But today is Connections Cafe. So if you're visiting with us, you've been here for a little while, but you want to know how to plug in, this is step one, okay, everybody? This is how we plug in, 30 minutes directly in my office following the service. All right. So I invite you to put out your hands to receive a blessing. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May you see him in your life, in your daily experience. Turn his face towards you and smile and tell you, you are loved. You are accepted. You are treasured. You are well planted. You got the Holy Spirit. You have everything you need. May the Lord bless you with not having everything you need. That he's done that in Christ. But may he bless you with the rest, the assurance, the knowing you can take it to the bank, that you have everything you need, that this world and all its troubles is actually a safe place to be, because one day that same God will make all things new. May you know that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Go with God. Hey, I apologize, everybody. I did not call the prayer team forward, please. Prayer team, come forward. If you'd like to receive prayer for any reason, those of you who are still hearing me, you can come forward. Thank you.